Welcome to the most awaited event of the court martial in ophthalmology. Well, this is a special, this is a disclaimer. The conversation and the scripts are created with a single point agenda of entertaining the viewers and making learning a fun. No intention to hurt, challenge, mock at the surgical and medical decisions taken by the relevant surgeons. Well, this is a special event for court martial team, not only because it is the 80th episode, but importantly today, for the first time, the court martial team has dragged the who's who in Indian ophthalmology into the convict box. Well, this is not just a game for us. It is a fight, not just between good versus evil, but the fight for humanity and fight for the poor. Being a high voltage and sensational nature of the case, and as whole Indian ophthalmology is at stake, we needed to have the most bright and most courageous and impartial judges from the Indian history to give fair trial and justice to my poor hapless patients. So we have invited Madhu Nidhi Chola, a judge in the court of Chola Kingdom, who was an upright and selfless judge of that era. He convicted his own son for cow slaughter. So our first judge is from the same land of Cholas, and it is none other than Dr. D. Ramamurthy. Welcome, Dr. D. Ramamurthy, sir, as a supreme judge. Well, Ram Shastri Prabhune was another such judge in the courts of Peshwa Kingdom who dared to give judgment against the rulers of kingdom, that is the Peshwas. So we have Ram Shastri Prabhune, also popularly known as Dr. T.P. Lehane, from the land of Peshwas. We are 100% sure that these upright judges have no personal relation with defense counsel or the convict on trial and would rise above the same to pass judgment against such heavyweights. Equally competent and fearless are young Turks in ophthalmology as our special jury. Dr. Madhu Shekhar, consultant cataract refractive surgeon with experience of more than 25,000 cataract surgery as first. Dr. E.K. Dalal, cornea and refractive surgeon trained from prestigious LVP, Hyderabad. Dr. Deepak Mishra, glaucoma consultant and associate professor at BHU, who has authored more than 21 books at such a tender age. Dr. Ilesh Jain, young director of Chitrakoot Eye Hospital, which performs more than 3 lakh cataract surgeries in a year. Dr. Tushar Grover, another cornea and refractive surgeon, and has won at such a young age prestigious best video in ASCRS. Dr. Rushad, who is a fellow from prestigious Narayan Netralaya with 17 publications to his credit. Another young VR surgeon from Ahmedabad, Dr. Path Rana, at such a young age, patent holder of 2 patents. And last but not the least, Dr. Soumil Kothari, another cataract and refractive surgeon from Mumbai and a trustee of Vision Foundation of India and non. Well, this new generation are not only daredevil surgeons, but carefree enough to bother and get bogged by the weights of this dawn whom they have to judge.
Maybe a little louder, Prashant.
Yeah. Okay. And today at trials are the dons and the kings of Indian ophthalmology who believe in divine right of the kings. And what is divine right of the kings? Which says that monarchs are not accountable to an earthly authority, that is courts of law. Well, the court martial team has dragged them into the courts. Today on trial are this stalwarts, Dr. Rohin Om Prakash from Amritsar, Dr. Mahipal Sajdev from Delhi, Dr. Lalit Verma, Dr. Namrata Sharma, Dr. Mohan Rajan, and Dr. Partha Biswas himself. Well, today we have 2 defense counsels, and this is for the first time that in the history of court martial that we have 2 defense counsels. Is it that they are afraid of the public prosecutor, his uprightness and fearlessness, or is it that the convicts are convinced that they are guilty? So let's see that. Well, this public prosecutor is a man who believes that no man is above the law and no man is below it. And every one of us will give an account of himself to the God. And he is today for the first time, yours, not so favorite probably, rude public prosecutor, Dr. Prashant. Well, friends, it's time now to begin the proceedings. So the first convict is here. We recently lost one of our most favorite athlete from Indian history who painted the name of our country on the canvas of Olympics. Yes, he was Milkha Singh, a flying Sikh. I bow before him and my salute to him. We have a marathon cataract surgeon from his own state, Dr. Rohit Om Prakash. Well, you will say, well, can this gentleman commit a crime? Yes, of course. I invite one of the most humble marathon cataract surgeon to the convict box. Dr. Rohit Om Prakash, sir, can you share your screen now?
If you just stop sharing, that
yes,
will be.
Sir. You have to first take oath in English.
Yeah.
Public prosecutor, stop calling you our defendant, sir.
Doesn't matter. He's already losing a game, so it's okay.
Sorry. This is partiality. The judge is directly, the Supreme Judge is...
No. I'm saying that you are too powerful.
The Supreme Judge is all in all, so he has the right to comment.
Supreme Judge, sir, I will bring to your notice that you have to play impartial game. You have to rise about the relation and not worry about the evening bread.
Prashant, this is contempt of court.
No, sir, the contempt of court is by the defense counsel. They are not in the defense, wearing the robes of the court. And if they are not wearing, in fact, they should be thrown out of the court for not giving respect, due respect.
Are you wearing?
Then what do I do for my dinner?
My defense counsel is not speaking up. I'm scared.
Don't you worry.
Let's get on with the proceedings.
Sometimes less said is more strongly said.
Honorable judges and the young jury, I am presenting trocar assisted fixation of trauma induced subluxated IUL back complex. Well, I'm coming to the results before my presentation. Well, the history was that there was a blunt injury 4 months back. And this is a patient who had a subluxated IUL bag complex. The pupil was circular, but it was small. So I thought that I'll start with the surgery. The first thing which I thought I'll do is I'll dilate the pupil. Well, dilating the pupil with the aid, there are a few tricks in it that I used. I targeted my zone, my area where I wanted to, the angulation of the incision so that I hit the target tissue. So I created 5 openings with the iris hook. I did not use any other aid because for me at this point of time, the only thing which would have worked in creating a better vision would have been an iris hook. These iris hooks have really come off well, and you can see how I was able to dilate the pupil. You can see I was not fully convinced about the placement of the suturing, which I would have done. So I have realigned the iris hooks. Next, I thought I'll use a trocar. So why I am using a trocar? Because this, I am basically a left-handed surgeon, and I thought it would be difficult for me to take care of the corneal, hitting and involving the corneal tissue in it. So I used a trocar. I had heard that trocar could be used, as Dr. Amar Agarwal had used it for iodo dialysis repair. So I thought I'll use it for the first time in repairing bag IUL complex. You can see it, how I am taking it in. What is the help of this trocar? You can angulate it in whichever direction, and it has made life very easy. This I thought was for the first time a trocar was being used by anyone to fix the bag IUL complex. So this trocar helped me, and with the raid rolling, role, I was able to take it out. Then I introduced the second one. I did not use any other technique, which Chee Soon Fek or Dr. Sonu Goel uses. So I thought I'll continue. And to my advantage, I could easily, you know, I was trying to put it in. I stopped with the retroillumination to have a better view and came out with a normal illumination. And then I railroaded it in without any problem into the 26 gauge needle and took it out. Once I took it out, then I thought the thing had become very easy. So I just pulled it, and here I wanted to titrate the positioning of the bag so that the IOL became centered. At this point of time, I thought I will not do bag fixation on the other side because of the simple fact that it was not a progressive thing which was happening because of some dysfunctioning of the zonules. So here I'm just completing it, repositioning it so that it comes back to the original state. I thought at this point of time, I will not use the other side because it was not a progressive one. Here I was able to use Trocar. Well, I was using Trocar for the fourth time in the life because I've never used it. I'm an interior segment surgeon. So contrary to the public prosecutor who uses it day in and day out, I thought that it was properly fixed for my ease. And here you can see that the bag has been perfectly centered. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Why is our public prosecutor quiet? He's stunned.
I'm coming. I have to share my screen. Let me point out what is happening.
He's wiping his eyes to find out what has happened.
Yeah.
The real surgeon in him.
So the marathon cataract surgeon from Amritsar, a high volume surgeon, always in a hurry. A single point fixation for such a gross subluxation, which was more than 180 degrees, glomerulolysis. Of course, he is in a hurry because he has a long OT list to cater to. So naturally, two-point fixation was not done. One. Second, why was not... You used 9-0 proline. Why not a CTR segment? You punctured that already fragile capsular bag with 26-gauge needle twice, thrice. I don't know how many attempts you made. But we could see two attempts and further weaken the thing. I think CTR segment would give it a more longer stability. Yes, you rightly said, I'm a vitreoretinal surgeon. You were playing or doing all the maneuvers in anterior vitreous. You didn't even bother to check whether there was any vitreous in the anterior chamber. No AuroCot, no confirmation of vitreous in anterior chamber, no anterior vitrectomy. Importantly, this was a case of trauma you have admitted. And you did not evaluate posterior segment for any of these disorders? Well, that was
quite... Objection, Your Honor.
Let me complete. I am not through. Why not, importantly, a new IOL? An SFIOL. You punctured cornea at 6, 8, 9 places. And again, use the same opacifying weak capsular bag just because you had an ego to show, to prove us that you are a superman. We accept you are a superman, but not at the cost of my poor patient's eye. You would have given a new IOL and a new vision to my poor patient. My lord, he has failed to do justice to my patient and has left the dangling sword of resubluxation of lens.
So objection, Your Honor.
And should be hanged.
Objection, Your Honor. Can I have all your points?
Just one moment.
Yes.
Good, Prashant. I mean, can you stop sharing and let's have the picture of all the... Yeah.
Thanks. So I would like to express my points because I first of all need to go to the other hall. First and foremost, Dr. Prashant, a CTR does not suffice with this extent of dialysis. It just gives some amount of equatorial support. Now, this we need to always look at the etiology of the condition, and this is a non-progressive condition, and the grace and the exquisite surgical skill which Dr. Rohit Om Prakash showed to fix it without making an incision, just a small side port incision, placing the trocar and a valve trocar will ensure that there is no IOP fluctuations, there is no fluid egress or viscoelastic going out or BSS going out. And the grace with which he planned and did the surgery is amazing. You think a man who could do this kind of exquisite surgery at one end would not do it at the other? The reason being, he knew this is all that is needed.
You have left my chances of resubluxation again, madam.
No, they will not traumatic dialysis. You need to go back and read your stuff again. This is a case of a trauma and not a progressive dialysis. He was addressing the visual quality and the decentered IO to be centered back to position.
The trauma.
I do understand. I feel sorry for you, public prosecutor. You are a retina guy. You might play a better field than Dr. Lad, the next person's case. But no, here.
Don't get personal now. I mean, now.
Your Honor.
Ikeda.
I think the jury would be.
I think a very beautiful surgery performed with such precision and very, very innovative to use the trocar for fixing the bag. I think the only thing probably I would have done differently is use triamcinolone to look for the presence of anterior vitreous.
Exactly.
But otherwise, I think it was perfect and it was very, very beautifully executed. And I'm sure he examined and felt that the other side does not need fixation because of the trauma.
Yes, sir. It was a nice surgery, sir. Actually, that use of trocar is new, and I think there is always chance of entrapment of corneal tissue when you are taking bite. And so this was new to me using trocar. And only thing, as you told, that staining of vitreous and doing good vitrectomy would be more useful in this.
So my poor patient had already 1 month by, later.
Don't interrupt them. Don't intimidate them. Dr. Patrana. You have to unmute.
It was an excellent surgery, sir. And first time I saw the use of trocar in NTA segment. But as a ocular trauma surgeon, I do a lot of this kind of surgery. And I have seen some of the cases, even after fixation of primary IOL, there will be subluxation from other side. So I always prefer to do new IOL, and I have patented mine. So,
we need to listen to the young jury.
Can't yourself here, just give your comments.
Yeah, so I prefer to do scleral fixated lens in this kind of cases because in trauma and undilated pupil, we don't know the exact status of zonules on other side. That's why.
Soumin?
It's a wonderfully done surgery, sir. And what I would have just done, not to take anything away from the surgery, but just a Hoffman pocket could be just an added tool to spare the conjunctiva on the other side. That's all. And otherwise, a very good surgery. In the next session, he's judging my surgeries. So I go for him.
Tushar?
Sir, it was a very well done surgery. The only thing I would say is probably preoperatively, we could also do a UBM to notice the amount of subluxation there was, to be doubly sure whether there is a subluxation in any other area as well.
So I think I did the, if I'm permitted to speak, I did the UBM afterwards also, and the result was there was only a minus 0.75 diopter at 105 degrees.
Additional evidences are not acceptable.
sir, I think has done wonderful surgery, and I only accept the point of the onculator that use of tricot is necessary in this. Rest, everything is wonderful.
Tushar, yeah, any final comments?
I would agree. Very beautifully done surgery, and the trocar actually a very new thing to do, but made it even more smooth and even more clean. So I absolutely agree with them on that. But also, I think the focus on the posterior segment, if there was any pathology, that should also have been paid some attention to. So I think that was the deficit there. But otherwise, beautifully done and very, very gracefully done.
I'm sure, Dr. Rohit, you would have had the posterior segment very well examined before you took up the patient.
That goes without saying, sir. That goes without saying because...
No additional evidences. Whatever you have submitted to the court is the final.
Supreme Judge, I think...
Now I come to my Co-Judge, Professor Lahane, for your comments. Sir, please unmute yourself.
Yes, yes, yes. I think I have seen the surgery, also the comment of everybody. The Prashant was saying that he has teared the capsule, but in the fibrosis, you have seen there is a fibrosis of the capsule. When there is a fibrosis of the capsule, after tearing also, that will definitely heal because it was not a normal capsule. It was a fibrosed traumatic capsule. And so whatever Rohit has done is correct. Secondly, some new things. See what happens, we are doing the same thing every time. And so it is a new thing that he has done with Trakar. So I think by my opinion, he has done an excellent job. And so I think he is to be garlanded and excellent job. I appreciate.
I think, I do agree that it was a fantastic surgery, meticulous and so much care. But with the success of SFI oils and iris clip lenses and lasting results coming out, we have to start wondering whether we need to sticking these bags back onto the sclera, because I think the long-term results of well-done SFI oils with various techniques are really good. And maybe on these cases, more than doing these very difficult surgeries, it might be easier to go ahead and even get the help of a posterior segment surgeon to do a good adequate anterior vitrectomy and then fix one of these lenses. And secondly, I think with the 90-degree subluxation, even though on the table, the lens was well fixated onto the sclera, maybe it would have been a good idea to fixate in two points. Though I do not agree with the fact that you could have passed on a CTS or something because it was a long-standing surgery and then the capsular bag would have completely fused down. And thirdly, I'm concerned about these proline sutures usage, that they do tend to degrade with the patient's long lifetime ahead of him. Whether this would last the lifetime of the patient. But otherwise, I think the means justify the end. At least as of now, you have got an excellent result. Jury, any one of you think that he should be hanged?
Yes, of course. You have admitted. The Supreme Court has admitted.
No.
There is a negligence.
No, sir.
Can I add one thing, Amurthy?
No.
You can't add. You are another defendant. Yeah. No, I think there was no need to, if you could salvage the...
Please, I'm asking the jury, please.
Okay, no problem.
No, sir, no.
No, I don't think.
Okay, so we virtual garland for Rohit. Great job done. That's wonderful.
Thank you. Congratulations, sir.
So should we go on to the next case?
Yeah. So this is it. We are garlanding Dr. Rohit Om Prakash. Thank you, Supreme Judge, for garlanding the person. Okay, now let's move on to the next presentation. Yes. Well, I think everyone knows this lady. Indira Gandhi personifies the epitome of women power in Indian politics. People love to hate and hated to love, but she prevailed for three decades in Indian politics and power. Well, we have our own secretary, AIOS, an epitome of women power, and a fantastic cornea surgeon, Dr. Namrata Sharma, secretary, AIOS. I request Dr. Namrata Sharma, madam, to step into the convict box and take this oath.
No, no, Prashant, I'm not able to hear you.
Pardon?
Not able to hear you.
No, there is some cross connection, I believe.
All others to mute themselves.
Please mute yourself. All the people request.
Admin, please mute everybody except
from the audio visual team only. Yeah.
Yeah. So can
I? Admin, please mute everybody.
I think is it, the defense counsel.
Somewhere else.
Ramamurthy.
Admin, hall coordinator, hall technician, where are you?
Hello. What is your team? How am I going to take my IOL inside? Take a lens of the I think that is Dr. Chitra Ramamurthy.
Hello. Yes, sir. Hello.
Yeah, backup team, where are you? You're not performing properly. Dr. Prashant.
Yeah. Okay, fine. So Indira Gandhi personifies the epitome of women power in Indian politics. People love to hate and hated to love, but she prevailed for 3 decades of Indian politics and power. Well, we have our own Indira Gandhi, secretary of AIOS, epitome of women power, and a fantastic cornea surgeon, Dr. Namrata Sharma. She's secretary of AIOS. So I request the secretary of AIOS to step into the convict box for all the misdeeds she has done. Madam, please do take this oath first, and then you can share your screen.
I have to speak this?
Yeah, of course. Without that, you cannot.
Okay, I solemnly affirm that the evidence which I shall give to the court shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
Let's hope for the truth only. You can share your screen.
I think I would like to say that I wanted to give another video, but Prashant and Chitra both bullied me into giving a more simpler video. So I've been forced, you know, already by the defense counsels, you know, into giving me a different video, but still I'll show you this.
That speaks about admission of your guilt.
Not about admission of my guilt. It speaks about the defense counsels, you know, who are already working behind the doors. Anyway, okay, so this was a case of capsular distension syndrome, a patient who was a myope and who was actually a high myope and had a capsular contracture syndrome referred from outside and had more myopia after the implantation of the lens. And so we are trying to do an intra-op OCT guided procedure for this patient and trying to relieve the phimosis by using an intravitreal scissors, cutting the phimotic band that is there. And with the help of the ILM peeling forceps, we are now removing this fibrotic band. Alternatively, you can use a micro forceps also for this, which is dedicated for this. And after removing this, irrigation aspiration is done, bimanual irrigation aspiration. This was, of course, sent for histopathological evaluation to look at the cells and the electron microscopy. And notice that this is the gap which is present between the lens and the capsule. And after relieving it, the capsule actually becomes a little shriveled, and you can see that there are corrugations there. And then subsequently, the irrigation and aspiration is being done from behind the lens. So that you can remove that fluid that is present between the lens and the posterior capsule. And then the wounds are hydrated. And notice how this lens now snugly sits on the posterior capsule, and there is no gap at all which is present between the two. And you can see that it is now moved just to the back of the eyeball. So this intra-op OCT helps you to actually titrate your steps better and relieves the capsular distension syndrome so that patient post-operatively had a good vision. So thank you very much for your kind attention. I don't think there is anything to say in this case.
Over to you, public prosecutor.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah. So, well,
so this was a referred case, Prashant. It was not done by me. So,
right. So she had no hand.
Don't accuse me of doing a small capsular excess. It was not done by me.
Now you need to let me do that, my job.
I request
one thing I must tell you. How are the convicts addressing you by your first name? Are the public prosecutor.
And also the Supreme Judge, they are using the same word.
Yeah. She may be the secretary, but she can't intimidate the public prosecutor.
Oh, no, okay. I am not trying to intimidate them at all. So, okay.
Let's begin. Well, one mistake leads to another. At first place, why did you ever do a small capsular CCC?
Am I
first surgery? You cannot speak, ma'am, now. You cannot speak. It was less than 5 millimeter, and my my poor client has already told that the first surgery was done by the great cornea surgeon at RP Center. He didn't want to get operated at Nagpur by me, and he went to Delhi for just because he wanted to get operated perfectly by you. Why a small CCC in the very first instance? Second, your capsulotomy is a simple, non-invasive procedure. You didn't even bother to attempt that. A small prick without taking him into the theater would have finished the job. Why did you ever take him for my poor patient for second surgery? You cut the CCC. You peeled off the residual capsule over there, madam. And if you remember right, you had placed a single pace lace in the bag. Now it will propel out because of the capsular contraction into the sulcus, leading to further problems. IOCT. Yes, IOCT. Well, do you need IOCT for a diagnosis? Well, you need a simple OCT in your OPD, which could have helped you. Was it really needed? In fact, I have another case in the second court where I'm going to plead because the IOCT you snatched off from your junior who was doing a DALC procedure where it was more badly needed. And all this shows was more of a Valery than a simple YAG capsulotomy. And you, I don't know whether you made money out of it, but definitely you got one more presentation award for this. So I think she should be hanged.
When do I have
objection? Objection, my own.
You cannot.
Ajoy is speaking on my behalf. I mean, objection, sorry. The defense counsel is speaking on my behalf.
The first point, well, my client already said that this was a referred case, a very bad case where there is a fibrosis, a small rexis done. The rexis would have gone and fibrosed it more. So she went and, I mean, everybody knows that a simple YAG does the job, but this was a different case. So she had to take it and tackle it in
a different way. Didn't even attempt it.
Yeah.
The patient was a fibrosis.
She removed it. She released it. And obviously, an anterior capsular fibrosis, which was the band which was there, that doesn't mean the lens would come off. Lens is there in its position. And then a beautiful
the integrity is lost.
You must have seen a lot of IOCT. This is where you live, you saw the fluid is there. She just took it out and the job is finished. And future chance of again forming some fibrosis in a small rexis, which is almost 3.5 millimeter done elsewhere. I mean, she's sitting on the tertiary, the apex center. She had to deal it, not what you do it in Nagpur. What she would do in Nagpur, she has done it what a tertiary center is supposed to do. And all that, I think you all learn from it. I plead my jury to look through this case and take your decision.
And my defense counsel belongs to the same plan of the...
Dr. Somil, your comments?
I agree with Dr. Prashant, sir, that a YAG capsulotomy would have done the job. I also agree that he's a high myope, but that does not mean that in every high myope, we don't even attempt a YAG. Nowadays, preoperative retina screening and postoperative retina screening and laser if required is easily doable. So I would definitely go in for a YAG in any CTS in general, I'm saying. I would not go in for a surgery in every myopic person.
Tushar?
So I would agree with that. I would have wanted a YAG capsulotomy to be tried first. And also the application of intraop OCT here, maybe not so much. So I would agree with the public prosecutor here, though it was obviously very, very nicely done. But I think we should have done a YAG first.
Rushad?
Same opinion. Basically, would have tried a YAG. The surgery was beautifully done. But again, probably would have tried a YAG first.
Exactly. I think you guys are being too brave. You are going to lose your membership.
Absolutely not. Absolutely. The Supreme Judge is trying to,
bully the my.
Can you mute yourself?
Siding with the.
Yeah.
Supreme Judge, Lahane will tell.
Yeah, you agree?
Yes, Art sir. Same thing, sir. I would have first tried IYAG, and then because it is high myopia, so madam has done a good job in doing that, releasing the capsular
construct phimosis and taking out the fluid. But YAG would be a better option, sir.
YAG would have sent the patient to Prashant Bhavankule. That's what you are waiting for.
Young juries, very good. Brave decisions. Don't worry. If they dislodge your membership, and they're going to represent against AIOS. Don't worry. Say, voice your opinion.
Please, Parth.
Yes, as I am a retina surgeon, it's not my topic, but ma'am has done excellent surgery, but as I have done some of the cases, and usually we have tried YAG only. I have never tried this, but ma'am has done excellent surgery.
Ikeda?
I think actually it was a beautiful surgery. I really enjoyed watching the video. Of course, yes, YAG can be tried in these cases, as everyone has already pointed out, but with respect to the surgery itself, I think it was really beautifully performed and demonstrated.
Beautiful surgery.
Would you like to say something? I mean, in Namrata?
No, we cannot take it.
Can I say now? I mean, I really don't know.
Yes, yes. My client is to give her final.
Dr. Ramamurthy, when do I say anything?
Okay, I'm asking you to say something now.
Okay. So this was actually a referred case, referred from somewhere else. And there was a myopic shift in this, and it was a high myopia of minus 14 diopters. And that is why you are saying that, you know, that lens is there. And it was done in such a manner that it doesn't actually dislodge out and get into the sulcus postoperatively. I don't think now, this is almost 3 years post-op, and the patient is doing well. YAG, of course, should be done in most cases. YAG should be tried first. But the only thing is, you can always have it, you know, again, despite the YAG also, cases have been reported when the fluid is there again. And we thought, because an anterior segment OCT was done in this before, and at that time only it was picked up in the OPD itself, that this is a capsule distension syndrome. And so we plan to relieve the phimosis, because phimosis itself will have its own set of problems in the long term. So we did it, and it happened, and it was IOCT demonstrated very nicely. The way, actually, I wanted to highlight was the way capsule behaves, which you actually cannot see otherwise when you see on the intraop OCT.
So we all agree that you got a great video. I mean, Professor Vlahane.
I also saw the video and the opinion of everybody. But see, the patient was referred, and when patient was referred, that person was having the YAG. After that also, why he referred? It means he was thinking beyond YAG. So of course, when we are doing it at the centers where the all things are not available, in that center we should consider the YAG. But the center like RP center, what Namrata did by doing the OCT, and then what she did, the that phimosis is removed and the fluid is removed. I think she did a great job. And so I think for me, that she should be garlanded.
Thank you.
It was impressive. It was an impressive surgery and very nicely demonstrated. But at the same time, I tend to agree with the jury, you know, in the sense that there is no sign of a YAG being tried at all. And in the YAG capsulotomy, it's not that you puncture the posterior capsule. What is recommended is that you puncture the edges of the phimosed anterior capsule. Multiple small nicks could have been made, and that would have, that's what is recommended as far as capsular distension syndrome is concerned. You, even in a high myopia, you're more concerned about damaging the posterior capsule. But here there was no sign of a YAG being tried at all. And even in case it had to be surgically intervened, there was no need to go ahead and peel off the entire rexus margin. You could have just made multiple nicks in the
leg
to overlap the lens and let the fluid.
I put in a word here.
So you are not there most of the time. Late.
You have not taken the permission to join back the proceedings.
Yeah, no. I think.
I did see her video. I think it was a brilliantly done surgery. There are 100 ways by which you can see the cat.
Let me just hold on. I mean, just hold on. Opinions of the jury. She should be hanged or she should be garlanded. Remember, you are going to be AOS members.
Don't get bogged. I am there.
Dr. Lalit Verma shall speak. I think he wants to speak.
Please raise your hands for hanging.
With hanging. Everyone, come on. Great.
Wow.
Garlanding.
Hanging.
Garlanding.
No. Only I'm asking only the jury. Anybody for garlanding?
Hey, only the public. No.
Oh, looks like madam has to be hanged. But Prashant, you should be hanged for showing Namrata with white hair.
I am never going to be with white hair, so it doesn't matter. You can see it only in the photos.
So how do you hang the secretary?
You cannot hang the. She needed me to fight for her. President can hang.
Yes,
yeah. Maipal is there.
He's already hanging.
He's no longer the president.
They will ask the Supreme Judge, Dr. Lahane sir, to do the needful.
Yes. She is garlanded and no. She is
sir, aap kya keh rahe ho ya ho gaya hai?
Aapki baat nahi sun raha hai tu.
Sir, yahan pe aapne garland bola, ye to.
Come on, let's carry on. Okay. Now, a brilliant Sardarji who pulled Indian economy from the dooms of collapse. Yes, our finance minister and later prime minister of our country, Dr. Manmohan Singh. We have another Sardarji in AIOS who has an excellent surgical skills and a financial economic acumen more than Manmohan Singh has, and has created an empire in the name of CFS. Well, friends, behind every fortune lies ... I didn't say that. It was said by Sidney Sheldon. Unlike Manmohanji, he is a vocal Manmohanji of AIOS. Sir, past president AIOS, it's time for now, you to come to the convict box and first take the oath in Punjabi.
Okay. Main rab di sau kha ke kehnda ke jo vi kahanga sach de siwa kuch nahi kahanga.
Juries, please do note the fluency of oath taking. It speaks about his n number of visits to the convict box. Points to be remembered.
I think the presentation can start.
So honorable judges and members of the jury and the Prashant Bhavankule, sir, the
public prosecutor, sir.
Yes, public prosecutor, sir. The issue is not, the issue is not my, how I spoke, because I've been to the convict box, but it is, one second, Prashant, just give me a sec. Okay. It's more because I am otherwise also eloquent and fluent. And so I'll be talking about this particular case. This is a case that I'll present to you. This is one particular patient who came to us a couple of months ago. And the patient had an active lifestyle person. He was having an injury with a shuttlecock. Okay. I have no financial
interest. We can't hear you, sir. Music a bit low.
I have no financial interest in this presentation.
Music can be lowered down.
Enjoy the music.
Okay, so this is to describe a 24-year-old boy.
We can't hear you. Mahipal, sir, please pop the music. We can't hear you.
Just once. Okay,
you can
so this
start
is
start the video from the beginning.
No, it's okay.
Okay, fine. Anyway, this is an IOL scaffold fourth row pupilloplasty. This is a patient who came to us. I have no financial interest. This patient came to us. He had a history of trauma and he was having glare and photophobia and SFTP, that is single fourth row pupilloplasty, that has been described by Amar in pseudophakic eyes. And in patients who are not pseudophakic, he recommends that these patients should be made aphakic and an IUL be placed and then the SFT be done. The problem obviously is the crystalline lens which is sitting there. And once you have the long needle with which you have to do the SFT, the chances of injuring the crystalline lens is obviously there. So this is a young guy who has glare, photophobia. He visited Nagpur for some famous retinal surgeon there. I don't know his name, but he got an indirect, everything done. Posterior segment was fine. But the retina surgeon said, kuch nahi ho sakta tera, you go back and basically put a contact lens. The patient was absolutely adamant that he did not want to put a contact lens. The patient came to us. We did a thorough examination, looked for angle recession, etc. And then we decided that we have to do something for this patient. So we decided that we have to do something for the patient. So in this particular case, what we have done is that We have taken the patient to the OR. We are doing it under a block, as you can see. And you can see the areas of sphincteric tear. There are multiple areas of sphincteric tear that are there. We made a side port incision. We put viscoelastic there. And what we then make is an incision, which is the main port, enlarge it slightly, because what we are going to do is something that has not been described in the world earlier. And we are going to put in an IUL. The IUL that we have seen or chosen is a plate haptic lens and not a normal lens, because a plate haptic lens will give you a large exposure or a large protective scaffold once we have to put the needle. So we are now putting this plate IUL. I could have also used an IPCL or an ICL, but since this lens has to be discarded afterwards, they were much more expensive. So what we are doing is that we are rotating it into the horizontal direction, because this is the area where I need a protection for the needle. So the needle that we are going to use, we are making a side port, and the side port that we are making, we are now going to have the long needle. You can see this is the long needle that we have with the proline suture. We will take a forceps from the other side, take the meat of the iris, and then pull the needle, and then we'll put a 26 gauge needle from the other side. Again, take a bite of the iris, put the 26 gauge needle, and then thread this long needle into the 26 gauge needle. So this was the most critical step, because if you fumble, you do anything, you have a sharp needle that can puncture the anterior capsule and the patient would end up with a cataract. So this was the main issue that we had to solve. Otherwise, it's just going to be a pupilloplasty that we will do. And now what we will do is that we will take out the lens, because the work of the needle has been done. So all we have to do now is to put the sutures, to tie up the suture after removing this lens. And therefore, you can see that I'm just doing a hand over hand. This is a capsular excel. I brought out the haptic and I'm doing a hand over hand technique and removing the lens. Once the lens has been removed, we just pull out the suture, which from one side, you can see, and we do the tying. This is the fourth row that has been done. We bring the throws into the center, and we will just tighten it up to the extent that you want. Since this was in the upper quadrant and we knew that the upper lid is going to cover, we just put one suture. If we needed, we could have put another suture, but this the post-op result was pretty good in this, and we'll just cut the suture and remove the viscoelastic from the eye of the patient. This is just the two port that we are doing, removing the visco. And once the visco has been removed, we will finish this surgery and do the hydration. And just for safety's sake, I'm going to just put one suture, and that is the end of the surgical procedure that is there. So friends, what I'm describing is a scaffold that we are wanting to have the surgical outcome that is there.
Well, well, well.
Yeah, I'll just stop this clip.
So. Yeah, please.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Well, juries, you accepted the upmanship shown by the past president of AIOS. He has accepted on record that it was for the first time. And you can note the first time, the way pride with which he spoke about. So let's come to the real point now. It was just a 6 millimeter pupil because of trauma. Did it really need pupilloplasty? One, a traumatic case, he is bound to have a traumatic cataract in a short time. If you are so afraid to injure the lens at this point of time, why not wait for another few months and then do a combined phaco, IOL and pupilloplasty? Wow, now you have put an ICL, injured probably some trauma you might have caused. Even the gods would create a trauma if you put an IPCL. And so you have induced that patient for early cataract surgery, which might have happened few months or few years later. Well, ICL for protecting a natural crystalline lens. Well, the first principle which is taught during surgery is that you have to be a minimalist surgeon. What does that mean? You have to restrict your steps to the few minimals so that each step is bound to carry certain baggages of complications with it. So friends, we put an ICL, then we remove the ICL, and that too to protect a crystalline lens. Well, we very conveniently forgot the injury which could be caused.
I should intervene. He did not use an ICL. It was a...
IOL.
Okay. I'm there to counter it.
Yes, complication of IOL.
I just want him to carry on with his foolishness and then come with the right story.
Now coming to the putting a bigger IOL instead of ICL, which he has created one more bigger problem. Bigger lens means bigger chances, more chances of injuring the natural crystalline lens.
Objection, Your Honor.
More space. Let me complete, defense counsel. And last but not the least, I think Dr. Mahipal is the last of the big spenders, or is it a valery, show of valery? Importantly, you put a lens, you remove the lens. Who is going to pay the bill? Who is going to take? Is it a corporate patient, or does it help in our own growth? Well, lot many things are unanswered.
Objection.
We need to put him
objection,
to
Your Honor. Objection.
You can stop sharing, Prashant.
Yeah. See, let's get to very simple basic fact. Only people with genuine problems will come to premium surgeons. So this was a man who was quite disturbed, young guy, a trauma and a traumatic midriasis need not relate to a cataract happening within a few years. It could have, if it had to happen, it would have started off. So he has gone around shopping, and then he had the confidence in this particular surgeon. And see how the surgeon, maybe the first time he did it, but look at the imagination of him to how to place a protection for the anterior lens capsule and do an amazingly simple surgery, and not leaving the plate haptic IOL for long in the back than is necessary, and taking it out and completing the case. There has to be a reason to protest, my dear public prosecutor. This was just a brilliant case. And believe me, if you are in the corporate world, you can look at getting business wherever you can, because you're looking at business
not
in your, cost of in your shop, nice. In
oh,
your
no,
shop
never, never.
And not outside. He was not
Puri,
charging
not.
More for that
it's
patient.
For money.
He the never said no, no.
Has accepted.
I never said that. I said you can do business in your place. But this was not making money. This was a salvage for a vision and a happy patient. I'm sorry, maybe you are scared of doing some challenging retinal cases, but we premium surgeons would like to do our best for every single patient. Thank
Let's
you.
Go down to the jury, Ikeda.
I think it was beautifully demonstrative, very, very innovative idea, sir. And I thoroughly enjoyed the surgeon. And I think the patient must have gone around. He must have significantly been disturbed by the glare that he faced after the trauma. And that's the reason why he was taken up for the surgery. Of course, we have the later on issues, which he's a young patient with small pupil, examining the retina later on might be an issue. But for now, I think the surgery was done very beautifully and must have had a good outcome.
Madhu?
Yes, sir. It was very innovative idea of scaffolding the clear lens. I think, as Prashant sir told, that placement of ICL in place of thicker IOL would be better, because it removal will be easier through a smaller incision. And I would have preferred to put one more suture distally, so to make the pupil more round.
Parth.
It was excellent surgery, and use of IOL was a really novel idea. But if patient was able to spend this much, there are some iris processes already available in the market that can be used. So instead of putting IOL there, we can directly put iris processes there. And that
iris
can
processes that can be put on top of a clear lens. Maybe only the lens will look you can put that only inside the capsular bag. Swamin?
Excellent surgery, of course, but needless to say that. But what I would have done preoperatively is I would have gone ahead with the aberration profile. I would have done an eye trace or some other aberration profile, seen if there are significant lenticular aberrations. In case if they were, I would have gone ahead with the cataract surgery. Although there's not, the cataract seems clear. Sometimes it just leads to a lot of aberrations after trauma. And you can simulate a smaller pupil even on an eye trace, say, for example. So otherwise, if there were not any significant lenticular aberrations, then what sir did was very good, needless to say that.
Rushabh?
A fantastic surgery. One thing that maybe would have reduced the cost is we are using contact lenses as scaffolds also. You can refine it and pass a suture through one end of it and push it in through the incision. So maybe you could use that. That would reduce the cost, but the concept was brilliant. And probably use Viscote against the cornea to protect the cornea during the surgery as well.
I think absolutely innovative idea, and anything that you're doing for the first time ever involves some risks. Some things could have gone wrong, but the important thing is they didn't, and everything went very smooth and it was brilliantly done. So I think that's something that we have to focus on.
So Ram, can I have my... The first thing is, that is why I used an Indian IOL, and I did not make money out of it, public prosecutor, because the Indian IOL manufacturer, I told him to give it free to me. The second thing, what has been made by Somil is correct, that we did do a vision, we did do a refraction. There wasn't any cataract. There was a full examination, and I have this patient for follow-up for 1 year. And Mr. Public Prosecutor, sorry, I didn't tell that, but the patient is doing 6-6 and the patient is very happy. So everything was done. It was just an idea, and you could see the multiple swing trick tears. There is nothing else that one could do. Basically, it was a shuttlecock injury and no cataract was there. And even if the cataract develops, say, 10 years down the line or maybe a little earlier, you can go ahead and do the surgery and then do a iris prosthesis, as Parth is saying. But I think I was scratching my brain as to what can be done for this particular guy, and he was really coming back to me again and again. Sir, kuch kar kar. I gave him a contact lens. He said, no, maine contact lens. He was so very adamant. He said, just do something. So this was the idea that came. What I'm saying is that classically the teaching has been to make the patient a phakic or pseudo phakic and then do a SFT. So how do you protect the crystalline lens was the this thing. Now people can enlarge on it. And
Professor Lahane, you have something to say? Professor Lahane?
He's in the other hall.
Okay. Yeah. I think this is a brilliant thought process. I mean, it's not a very difficult surgery, but it's the concept behind which has to be appreciated. I'm sure there will be many of us taking this up subsequently. But you can get a free IPCL also. Maybe using a phakic intraoc lens would have created a smaller opening. Might have been easier to manage. And the second thing is, Maipal did mention that it's going to be covered by the lid, but maybe passing a second suture would have been a good idea. And one small point I want to make is that I saw the needle going through the iris. I mean, I would have rather passed, the 26 gauge while railroading. I've had the occasion when that torn up the iris, I'd always pass the proline suture needle through the iris and hold the other needle on the other side, because sometimes the hole it creates is...
The needle went through from one side, the other side, the 26 gauge needle went, and the initial.
What I'm trying to say is, I would rather pass the proline needle through both the wings of the iris, because the 26 gauge needle going, just a small point, going through the iris sometimes creates a bigger opening which is uncontrolled. Otherwise, but I think there's no need even to ask. All the jury seem to be in agreement with the concept. So, Garland from the president, the ex-president.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
And be better prepared, public prosecutor. You were really, really pathetic in all your...
I had to leave you. My AIS future is at stake. I can't afford to.
Thank you.
Okay.
A humble submission. Well.
Well. So, do you remember this character from Mahabharata, the Bhishma Pitama of Mahabharata? Well, he saw the generations of Pandavas come and go, but he still held the forte. Bhishma Pitama of AIOS is our own accomplished vitreoretinal surgeon who has donned the role of secretary, chairman scientific, and now vice president, and now the president-elect of AIOS. Now I welcome President-elect of AIOS to come to the convict box and take the oath first, and then he will start sharing his screen.
मैं सत्य निष्ठा से पुष्टि करता हूँ कि मैं जो कुछ कहूँगा सच कहूँगा, सच के अलावा कुछ नहीं कहूँगा.
Okay.
Thank you, Court Martial team for having me here, and honorable judges, and defense counsel, and the young jury, please listen to this case and decide yourself whatever I have done is good for the patient or not in the circumstances which were there. So I hope the screen is visible.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
So you see, I was dealing with a patient who did not get operated for reasons best known to him. Primarily, he was a high myope, and a lot of people had scared him that in a very high myope, if you have a vitreous surgery done, you may not improve or land up in per-operative complications. And there may be issues during...
I'm seeing a different screen, sir, from you. Some retinal hemorrhage during VR surgery. Is it the same screen?
Yes, yes, it's the same screen.
Fine, fine, fine.
So this is the story of this gentleman, which I had seen a month ago only. Basically, he had a detachment with a horseshoe tear, which I thought was this is the picture here. Let me take you to the video straight. Since he was a young patient, I did a buckle here. Because however confident you may be, you notice this, there are thinning of sclera. You can see the blue sclera, blue uvea shiny through it. And I was very careful that sutures have to be very superficial. I put this band all around to support the vitreous base and then proceeded with the MIVS surgery. And once I did the core vitrectomy, the initial part of removing the central core vitreous, what I noticed here was this hemorrhage here. If you notice on the temporal side, there was this hemorrhage here. So this raised an alarm. What is this? Because I just begun the surgery at that time. And vitrectomy had not been completely done. So I put a PFCL. And this is the positive horseshoe tear. And as is usual, you do vitrectomy around the horseshoe tear also. Then mark this with the help of diathermy. And there was some element of PVR, which was taken care of with the help of diamond dusted and this MVR blade. And this membrane, epithelial membrane, was removed, as you see here. Fortunately, it was not a very extensive PVR. And then I proceeded for drainage. Point to be noticed here is that there was a track, if you see this track, which was communicating with the inferior retina. So I suspected this could be a complication of the perivulvar block, which had been given prior to surgery. This track made me quite suspicious because I was pretty sure that during passage of my buckling sutures, there was no issue at all. So I still proceeded with the airflow exchange, and dilemma in the mind was whether to take care of this subretinal heme or not, because it was slightly away from the macula. So we did this airflow exchange, marked the retinotomy, take a guy, and the retina became flat. Once the retina became flat, I did try to take out this subretinal heme because I thought presence of subretinal heme, even though in the macula is an urgent situation, but in a paramacular area also, it will lead to a lot of scarring. In the future, he may develop PVR, subretinal bands, and may unnecessarily require a resurgery also. So I took this back flush green tip needle, and under air, I tried to remove this blood. It was difficult, but I, gradually increased the suction. Short of doing a retinectomy, so this took care of part of the blood. You see, if you notice here, part of the blood has been taken care of. So since it came easily in the upper part, so I thought I will make another retinotomy here. This was near the arcade. And again, increase the suction. Caught hold of this clot first. You see, very important that atraumatically you catch hold of this clot. And also notice a track going here in the inferior part. And fortunately for me, and fortunately for the patient also, this clot came out in the entirety. And you notice now at the end of the surgery, the entire blood clot, which was subretinal and which had propensity to cause a subretinal PVR in the future, came out. And then I filled up with silicone oil and lasered this retinotomy areas. and did a laser round skull break, also horseshoe tear, and all around. And ultimately, patient had a good result post-operatively, and patient regained 6x18 vision. This is the pre-operative and post-operative picture of the same. These are pictures taken during the surgery, and from the video capture, I took a still photograph. You see this large subtle clot, which could have been left, but the reason I took it out was to have a good future attached retina without any subretinal band, subretinal PVR, and patient ultimately did very well. Thank you very much. So this is my case I submitted before the.
Thank you, sir. You can stop sharing the screen.
Yes. So leave it to the jury to decide.
Sir, you are a surgeon from the era of my teachers like Dr. Lingam Gopal, Dr. Badrinath and all, who loved buccal. This is a patient who had a single horseshoe tear, what I note, at 3 o'clock with a PVR almost less than grade B. Why was not a buccal done? A simple non-invasive procedure. You accepted it was a young patient, most importantly. Fine. You erred on the side of primary vitrectomy, which you should not have at your experience. Then why put an encerclage? Why not a vitrectomy without encerclage? And that too in an eye which was myopic, you accepted. And the, when you dissected the conjunctiva, you could see a uveal show through the thin sclera. Why continue with the insistence of putting a buccal at the cost of creating a subretinal hemorrhage? Importantly, a belt buccal or an encerclage means additional risk of extrusion, infection, whatnot. Why not you did a sutureless buccal, not only to prevent bleed, but also to prevent infection? Other thing is, you used 4-0 silk with a round body needle. You could have used a spatulated needle to prevent hemorrhages like that. Most important point is there was a subretinal heme. Once you have a subretinal heme, the removal was attempted under air. In fact, the air pushes the retina against the choroid, making the life difficult. And that's why you created 3 retinotomies. Importantly, 3 retinotomies to my poor patient with a single horseshoe tear that converted the whole simple buccal procedure into silicone oil, and silicone oil meant one more surgery. What was the intention behind all this? I think the juries are prudent enough to understand. Yes, my lord, my patient's vision is 6-18. Otherwise, he would have had 6-6. And that's what we expected from one of the best vitreoretinal surgeons in Delhi and across the country. And that's why the patient moved out from Nagpur to get operated by the famous Dr. Lalit Varma. So he didn't stand up to his expectation.
Objection, Your Honor. Yeah, left to him, he would talk for 1 hour. So, public prosecutor, as a defense counsel, I may not be able to defend my defendant to the same extent, but I would like to tell you that in the phakic eye, if first of all is the confidence of a surgeon to take a step or take a decision or to do a particular way, when he feels that in that particular case, that will get the most optimal result.
Young patient,
young patient, that's why that encerclage was used. That's why he elaborated how carefully he took the suture, how he protected the sclera. And it was not just the horseshoe tear. He knew that subretinal blood being there. He acknowledged that it was not because of the suture. It could be because of a block, which can happen in a high myopic
eye. Happened at his hands.
He was such an honest surgeon. He acknowledged the issue there. But being the great surgeon of his kind, he beautifully did one retinotomy. He was not going to do a slipshod job. He didn't mind doing double retinotomies more, because anyway he was going to diathermize it. He was going to seal it. He wanted something most optimal. And deep in your heart, you know as I know that that was an ultimate surgery. Iatrogenic issue also well addressed. And you can't crucify a person who has got the most optimal end result. I'm sorry.
Honorable Judge,
let's come to the jury.
Just beat around the bush and didn't accept the logical.
Public prosecutor has not done his homework.
You have your chance. I mean, Parth, I think you are a vitreoretinal surgeon. Let's have your opinion.
Sir, it was an excellent surgery, and he combined, he did all of whatever he can. Like he started with the buccal.
Is there in vitreoretinal surgery?
Yeah, definitely. Buccal, vitrectomy, and even he removed the subretinal heme. So whatever best he can do for his patient, he has done, and he can do more.
Complication and then tackling it. Not expected from Lalit Verma.
The complication was not created by him.
All the other jury members are essentially cataract surgeons. If any one of you has a comment, please speak up.
I would just like to say,
yeah, please, Soumil,
that the confidence of the surgeon shows through this case, even to a non-vitreoretinal surgeon. And the videos were excellent.
So all I could do was appreciate the finesse and the beauty of that surgery, I think. So.
Lalit, I would just like to say hats off.
My problem is that public prosecutor has not done his homework at all. In fact, he should be banned from arguing any cases. The reason I'm saying so is hats off to my defense counsels who have defended so well, and to the honorable jury members. You see, on one hand, he admits that there is a thin sclera. On the other hand, he wants me to put a buccal there. You see, how can in a thin sclera you can put a buccal, which is virtually contraindication for putting a buccal. So, Mr. Public Prosecutor, please do your homework. And secondly, the three retinotomies were done to save a retinectomy. If you have to remove such a large clot, you do a small retinotomy, because from the first it came out partially. And if you do a large retinectomy, not only the anatomical result, but the visual results tend to get compromised. You see, remember, each retinectomy done compromised the visual result by at least 10 to 20%. And since the patient is happy, and there was a PVR also. You see, in practice, you can't have two chances. You can't try buccal first and then do a VR. So I did the best for the patient. I combined a buckling band and a settling band with the VR, and patient is happy, and there's no reason for public prosecutor to be unhappy.
My co-judge, Dr. Lahane, you have anything to say?
I think I'm not a retina surgeon, but I see the Pritam operative. I think he also does the retinotomy to remove this clot. Yeah. And I think what Lalit did was, I think it was a very excellent surgery he did. I think what happens, there is always a prejudice in the retina surgeon. And I think it is because of that, this public prosecutor is a retina surgeon. So he is prejudiced, and because of that, he might be saying. But by my opinion, he should be garlanded, and he has done an excellent job, excellent demonstration, and excellent video. Thank you.
Lalit, just a couple of questions. I was an ex-retina surgeon, in the sense that, you know, somehow, though you did say the sclera is a little thin, young patient, just a regmatogenous retinal detachment, that too partial. Don't you guys don't do buckling at all these days? And secondly,
Let me answer this. The PVR, if there was no PVR, I would have attempted. We do buckling, love to do buckling still. There's no issue about doing buckling.
PVR was not very extensive in this case. You hardly did any membrane feeding or anything. I mean,
localized PVR.
There was some editing involved. The entire PVR was not visibly shown because that was not a good segment visible there. So, but you see, you can't have two surgeries. This is what I want you to tell. You see, problem was in a patient where sclera is shining through. Let me finish. When the sclera is shining through, UVA is shining through, there's a blue sclera, buccal is virtually contraindicated. You can't pass buccal sutures because of the thin sclera. So I remember one case which assistant Dr. Tiwari, he was a big shot of Delhi's sales tax. So as soon as we did the peritomy, we saw this blue sclera. And immediately we aborted the surgery of buckling and 52 VR surgery. So thin sclera is a contraindication for doing a buccal procedure.
And as it was a blood clot, and you know, it was a clotted blood that you took out, and it was well away from the macula. I mean, could you have just avoided those retinotomies and just left the blood as it is? And one of your retinotomies is very close to one of the vessels. I mean, should it have been a little far away?
That I would agree with you. I had a dilemma whether to do it or not. I tried one retinotomy, it came out. That gave me confidence if some part of blood from the superior part can come out, let me try to remove the entire blood. Because from the superior part, only around 10 to 20% of the blood clot came out. So therefore, I made, and there was no continuity between the entire blood clot. So if it was a continuous clot, I would have removed from the one retinotomy. But since it was not continuous, so and first retinotomy yielded me good result. So I attempted another and entire blood clot came out.
Good. Well done. I think there's no need to ask. Lalit has to be garlanded. I think the jury is quite uniform in their opinion.
Yeah. Thank you. Garland him for his valiant surgery, sir. We salute you for the beautiful surgery.
Thank you, my defense counsel. Thank you, judges. Thank you, young jury. Thank you so much.
And public prosecutor also, sir. I didn't make half hearted attempt.
I think Prashant has agreed. That is my biggest victory. Biggest victory is to win over public prosecutor.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Well, Prashant, everyone knows Rajni.
No, Prashant, I think we might have to hurry up a bit. You have to.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Yes.
No, it's 12:20 only, sir. Up to 12:55. We have two more cases only.
12:55. Okay, yeah. Fine.
Okay.
So I think it's 12:25, no? It's only 12:20.
Okay, then we move ahead fast. Okay, fine. Give me some. Okay. Well, this showman, the heartbeat of South India with maximum Filmfare Award. We have Rajni in our own ophthalmology. I mean a person with maximum OPL trophies, Dr. Mohan Rajan. But unlike Rajni, who has no qualms about aging, balding, this phaco surgeon spends much more time in front of the mirror than his beautiful wife does. Here we present the superstar of Tollywood, Dr. Mohan Rajan. Your oath, please, sir, in Tamil only.
I think we have to be very concise. We have to...
Okay, we can go to directly to the... start sharing the screen. Mohan, sir.
Mohan, unmute yourself.
Mohan, unmute yourself.
Unmute.
Unmute, Mohan. We can't hear you.
Come directly to the video, sir. Shall I play the video for you? Mohan, sir, can you hear us? Hello.
You can't hear us, I think. You can't hear us. I think maybe you can take Partha and by the time.
Yeah. Audiovisual team, help us out in moving to the next presentation.
He's been having some problem on his video.
I unmuted now.
Yeah, okay.
I will share my screen.
Please, make it fast, sir.
Very sorry because I have a course to go.
You go and start with your video straight away.
Yeah. I'll start with my video. The surgical plan was flax, CTR, IOL in the bag, a sulcus, SFT. And this is a preoperative picture, traumatic cataract, shuttlecock injury. And I'll go to the video straight away. Yeah, this is a patient history. 20 years back, it says... he had a sink, so we planned to have a flax for him because it makes life easy for us doing the rexis and doing the nucleus removal, everything. You can see this flax, the rexis is already there. We have about 3 to 4 o'clock hours. I just put some iris hooks there to support that area. And the advantage of the flax is that already it's a pre-cut, though it's a mature cataract. Yesterday also I was talking about it. The flax can penetrate even a mature cataract. Can see the cuts on the thing, a very gentle hydrodissection and very little rotation of the nucleus. You can just pick up the all the pieces without any problem. So I'm just putting 2 hooks there because the iris hooks normally have this thing on the other and equal, what you call, traction. And I don't keep too much of traction on the bag. Just enough traction for me to... make sure that every time I break the again, even rotation of the nucleus, all the pieces come into the port. And every time I come out of the eye, because it's a loose bag as well, I inject the viscoelastic, like Hyaluron, cohesive viscoelastic, and go ahead and the cortical cleaning, and then I remove the iris hooks, and then put the CTR in this particular patient, and then because the patient also had a traumatic mitriasis preoperative, the pupil size was almost about 8 millimeter, and obviously I have to take care of the traumatic mitriasis as well. So I just put a single piece lens, I'm sorry, in the multi-piece MA60 lens, and into the though I have a good bag as well, but I thought I'm doing this technique for all pseudo exfoliation patients. So I thought I'll just put it in the sulcus and capture the optic into the bag. The end point is the ovalization of the capsular excess margin, which indicates that the lens is locked very, very well. This lens is almost like lens in the bag, and absolutely no problem at all. No pseudophakodynosis, and the lens is also very stable in the long run. We have seen that in pseudo exfoliation, many other patients as well. And I did the single pass four throw pupilloplasty. And you can see here multiple throws are being done. It's a beautiful method which has been described by Amar Agarwal. And I do that to reduce the pupil size. Obviously, we have to reduce the pupil size because the patient is going to have glare because of 8 millimeter. And we have to reduce the pupil size to less than maybe 2 or 3 millimeter or so. And that's what I did at the end of the surgery. You can see here multiple throws are being done. I don't believe. Of course, Amar does, but this is not an indication for pineal pupilloplasty. You just have to make the pupil size small enough for so that the patient does have very good visual acuity and no glare as well. You can see here, the patient had a fairly good visual acuity at the end of the surgery, and this post-operative vision of 69N6, and the patient was very happy. Thank you very much for the wonderful opportunity.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Well, friend, this is a man with maximum OPL trophies, and he had to show his valor. Well, sir, here is my first question. This retired gentleman who was having a trauma 20 years back, why in a retired poor guy flags and charge him 1.5 lakh rupees, and that too for a minimal subluxation, not an indication for flags. 3 clock hours of subluxation only. Does it really need a CTR? Well, you could have aligned the haptics in the same and it would have taken care. Well, you charged him phenomenally 1.5 lakh and instead of using the capsular hook, you decided to use iris hook in that case to support the capsule, and that too only 3 clock hours. Traumatic mitriasis, the patient in his active young age when he was working, he did not get bothered by it. And now you need to do pupilloplasty. And what happened? Finally, you had an eccentric pupil. So,
objection, Your Honor.
Was it a short salary or no?
Can I objection. Talk?
No, I would be talking.
We'll come to you then.
Yes.
Yeah. What I would like to address here is that if you have a challenging case and flags, if you can explain to the patient whether it's a polar cataract or a subluxated, flags is the best way to go because it is here wherein the manipulations become so less that area of dialysis would not increase. If at all, then flags is the answer. Again, a CTR, a capsule hook or iris hook is mainly to give you some kind of an anteroposterior support, but the CTR gives you an equatorial support, and CTR is needed in subluxation. Just a haptic will not suffice. There would be an asymmetric back contracture, which happens later on. IOL might pretentiously look centered on the table.
He must have increased the subluxation that
no, why he did not. He cannot increase. He has done a great surgery with flags, the right choice, a CTR, the capsule hook to give his visibility, and then he has not only really done that, the most important thing is he has left the haptic in the sulcus and then done an optic capture which would prevent pseudophakodynosis, which would prevent a back contracture later on. So very well done case, and of course he has combined it with pupilloplasty because that's the best you can do for a patient, and Dr. Mohan Rajan has done it all. So honestly, I don't even think we need to go through a round.
Let's come to the jury. I mean, quickly, Tushar.
Sir, I would agree with the choice of doing the femtosecond laser surgery and with the use of the CTR. So I'm totally for that. The pupil I did feel was a little eccentric, but I think still would have provided a good visual outcome to the patient. So I think the right thing has been done.
Ikeda?
So a couple of points, a very beautifully done surgery, but talking about what I would like to do differently, definitely use of capsular hooks because they have the blunt olive tip. They are definitely more atraumatic and would prevent further damage to the back. So that is one thing. I think CTR placement is a very good choice and it's not, doing anything additional which is not required. You can easily place a CTR. In this case, I feel if it was only 3 clock hours of subluxation, we could have placed the IOL in the bag and placed the haptics in such a way in the area of subluxation so as to make sure that it is stable and, avoid problem in the long run. Since it was a mature cataract and we have done a pupilloplasty, if it's a traumatic cataract, the patient has just come to us and he has not been examined by the retina specialist previously, then a very small point that we have not seen the fundus and postoperatively that might be an issue. But those otherwise, the surgery was very, very beautifully done.
Naumil?
Very good surgery, but flax is needed. One, in every case, it helps. Second, because rexus is the most important step in subluxated cataracts. If we get that right, we have solved half this. We have won half the battle. Second is probably I would have gone in for a CTR placed slightly earlier than what sir did, but nonetheless he did place it at an appropriate time and nothing happened. Most importantly, so that's fine. What I would have done differently is I would have gone in for a purse string pupilloplasty rather than a single pass fourth row. Because at his level, I would expect that to have a properly circular pupil rather than having multiple pupil holes sort of a thing. So although it's easier to do a single pass fourth row for a general ophthalmologist, but sir is far beyond that. I expect posting pupilloplasty for
12:25, the session should have got over. So yeah. I think we can't be asking all juries now. I mean, Partha's case, I don't know how we can hear.
I think more importance should be given to the youngsters. Very brief comments, Rusha.
I agree completely with Saumil. Actually, I would have probably placed the CTR ring a little bit earlier. And also agree that we would probably use capsular hooks rather than iris hooks in this, but agree with the management otherwise. And flax is definitely useful in these cases because the rexus tends to increase the amount of subluxation also. You'd be putting more stress on the zonules by doing a manual rexus.
Madhu?
I'm not in favor of flax, sir, because it was mature and long standing case. So there must be anterocapsular fibrosis with mature cataract. So it will not penetrate, that femto laser will not penetrate and it will make your surgery more difficult.
Parth?
It was excellent surgery, sir. And I would have placed just CTRing a little bit earlier, nothing else. The rest of the things were excellent, sir.
I think Mohan and Dr. Lahane, we'll skip our comments. Overall, I think it was a great surgery and we garland Mohan.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm leaving because I have another
question. Yeah, please.
Thanks, yes, sir.
Yeah, so this is the garland for him.
Thank you, Bobby.
I think
coming to the last.
Ramamurthy, I'm also leaving. I'm going in other hell. So now you take care.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for being
here. Don't hang anyone.
Okay.
Sir, you have to be here, sir. For me, you have to be here, sir.
I am there, Partha.
Okay.
Don't worry, I'm there.
Let's move.
We're all there for you.
Shashi, thank you, doctors, for the wonderful session. And thank you for finishing it on time.
Okay, give us 5 minutes. Shashi Tharoor, the gentleman has this canny ability to convert limpid to sycophepedilian to ostentate and rhodomontolate his court martial to this level. He unravels convolutionary situation by his perspicacity. Let me speak in simple English. He has the canny ability to make clear, simple words into long, dramatic dialogue.
Sir, please cut it short. I mean, let's come to the video.
Yes, to market his self-boasted court martial. So here is the secret sub-analysis of voting pattern in AIOS, which revealed his major voting share from females. And so he's the Shashi Tharoor of AIOS. Well, I'm talking about my dear friend, Partha Biswas. Partha, now you can start. Partho?
Yes. So this is a journey of 20 years with a very challenged eye. I will go fast a little bit. It's a story of 1999, and it's about a young novice surgeon who dared to do a challenging case in a one-eyed patient. And this was the one-eyed patient, and this was the surgeon.
Volume.
So this was the surgery, and it was an uveitic cataract. And when I did the surgery, I removed off all the synechia that there was, and it was a dilated pupil. So I did think that, yes, I would get a good rexus, and I did stretch it a little, because in all these uveitic cataracts, it's important to stretch it, because that, in fact, releases some amount of the tension of the fibrosis that has gone on onto the pupil. And you can see that it is an adequately done pupil, 6 millimeters, 6.5 millimeters, and I'm able to get nice rexus without putting any hooks or devices, and that completes it. Please remember that I was quite a novice surgeon at that point of time. And then I'm doing the nucleus management and taking off the nucleus, but then this becomes difficult, and the pupil is shrinking, and it's a thick plate of epinucleus which I cannot get out. And so I've resorted to a hydrodissection, and unfortunately the iris is coming out, and it's becoming a little difficult for me, but I go in from the side port and tweeze off the iris from the main port, which has prolapsed. And then, of course, in the center part, keeping my phaco needle right in the center, I'm able to do off a good nucleus management. And I place a three-piece hydrophobic intraocular lens in the back. So this done, that becomes the end of the surgery, and we do not have much mishaps. But as with all uveitic cataracts, there are problems. And this one-eyed lady, a very, very nice person, she followed up with me. But there was repeated inflammation, recurrent iridocyclitis. At one point of time, CNVM developed. We used anti-VEGFs multiple times. And ultimately, despite there was pupil obstruction and Elchnik pearls came on, and repeatedly we had to do YAP capsulotomy. And finally, we had hardly any view. The vision had dropped, and we had to do something about the obstruction of the vision, and this was what it was. So this is the last part, and it's just about a 1 minute video, and this is what had happened. It had obstructed the visual axis, and we had to do something about this. So we take this patient up, and we need to be very careful because it's a fibrotic bag, it's a one-eyed individual, and high molecular weight viscoelastic is being used. I'm trying to take off as much of synechia as possible and trying to create basically an opening between the edge of the pupil and the anterior capsule, which is fibrotic. So once I do this, then I have some space wherein I cannot actually manually separate out. It will never manually separate out because it's too thicker synechia. What I will have to do, and the bleeding has started occurring, I'm placing in viscoelastic as much as possible and trying to create that space. Only that space is important, and then the vitrector comes in, and that's the most important part of the whole exercise, which is simple, but if it is not handled well, it can become quite difficult. And at this point of time, it's not only the fibrotic bag which has shrunk, the anterior capsule which has shrunk, but also I'm taking off the collaret of the pupillary margin, and thereby ensuring that this pupil will not shrink. And I'm trying to see to the fact that we just have an adequate pupil. No use of devices at this point of time is required. And we try and keep it. And as you can see, that it is quite nice and pristine while we are doing the whole procedure. But of course, the bleeding can occur, and therefore a tamponade will be warranted as and when required. So this, with this done, and you can see that the tamponade is important, and we need to wait a little to see that there is no hyphema. So this is the post-operative picture of this patient, and thank you very much for your patient hearing.
Of sharing the screen, please. Please stop.
Just a clarification, Partha, what about the condition of the other eye and investigative?
One-eyed patient, sir. One-eyed patient. So one-eyed patient right from the beginning.
So sorry to interrupt you, doctors, but we have already
5 minutes left. Quickly, Prashant, if you can just tell the trial and then
we have to get started with the next session also.
Yes, yes. Thank you.
He's a novice surgeon. He's misleading the court by his sweet words. No steroids preoperatively. These are the studies which say that he should have used preoperative steroid, NSAI, NSAIDs before surgery.
I did use my
one. one-eyed patient, 5 to 6 millimeter dilation after visco separation. Why Kuglund dilators to damage the sphincters and induce a uveitis in an eye which was under remission? Second surgery, why not use a Bhattacharya iris device or any other ring if you wanted to dilate? Case two, no trial of YAG or atropine. Recurrence of a membrane, dear friend, uveitis is a recurrent problem. You have induced uveitis by cutting of the chinging of the iris tissue. And that means not only permanent lifelong disability to constrict, but also inducing new uveitis. So don't be surprised if you have a membrane, again, few things.
Question, Your Honor. Yeah, I would just like to confirm.
Do you think sharing the second name of giant in uveitis, Dr. JB, gives you wisdom of uveitis? My Lord, he is guilty not only of negligence, but for presumptuous and showing unnecessary valor in a one-eyed patient at such a tender age when he was novice. So he should be hanged.
Objection, Your Honor. I think the surgeon definitely showed great valor in this particular surgery. The primary surgery, just that stretching, I'm sure he would have given all the pre-op medications, all the post-op medication in this rapid 4 minute, 3 minutes. He has not elaborated on that. Any sensible guy would have done that, and he would have definitely kept the steroids on longer, and he had to remove that one-eyed man. He needed the vision. He had come back to him for so many injections for a CNVM which had occurred that showed the loyalty which the patient had, but you need to give vision, and that fibrotic membrane cannot be yagged. It will cause pitting on the lens. So it has to be cut and it has to be vitrectomy has to be done. He did it in a very gentle fashion.
And finger giving further uveitis.
No. He wanted it a little more enlarged pupil so that the lesser chances of a PS occurring. And I'm sure he would have given a bolus of IV steroid at that time. And later he would have followed up that patient. So I think that was valor for a one-night patient. The next day, the patient reading few letters, he would have fallen at his feet. So I think I need to go to the next hall. Kudos to you, Dr. Partha Vishwas.
I think we are very much short of time.
Yes, sir.
And anybody has anything negative about the surgery? Just a very small comment. Otherwise,
okay. Yes, sir. Let's close.
The only thing negative is that 1999, he was not a novice surgeon. He was already 10 years into his practice. So he was lying about his age.
Yeah.
great job, Partha. Well done.
Thank you.
flowers to the...
Flowers.
Thank you.
Open and shut case.
No, I intended to take care of his, if you could have hanged him. Well, fine. This is the flowers for him. And so thank you, friends. Thank you, Partha, for this opportunity. Thank you, Ayaz. And thank you, Supreme Judges. Thank you, public prosecutors and all the young judges. Thank you, Partha, once more.
Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. Thanks for the session.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thickness and topography, a pencil retina exam, and once the